Revealed to little ones the mysteries of the kingdom. Jesus proposed another parable to the crowds, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a man who sowed good seed in his field. While everyone was asleep, his enemy came and sowed weeds all through the wheat, and then went off. When the crop grew and bore fruit, the weeds appeared as well. The slaves of the householder came to him and said, 'Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where have the weeds come from?' He answered, 'An enemy has done this.' His slaves said to him, 'Do you want us to go and pull them up?' He replied, 'No. If you pull up the weeds, you might uproot the weeds along with them. Let them grow together until harvest. Then at harvest time, I will say to the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles for burning, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Please be seated.
In today's Gospel, Jesus is teaching the crowds about the kingdom of God, using a parable about wheat and weeds. And in cultivation, there are three main moments: planting, growing season, and harvest. And this parable, in many ways, follows those three moments. Our Lord using a parable of cultivation, and in it, he has those three moments. So I want to review the parable to see what is he saying to us today about the kingdom of God and living a life of faith. His parable begins first with the planting. "The kingdom of heaven may be likened to a man who sowed good seed in his field. When everyone was asleep, his enemy came and sowed weeds all through the wheat, and then went off." That is essentially the first part of the parable, corresponding to planting and cultivation. And it contrasts the householder, the man, with his enemy. The man, it says clearly, sowed good seed, which we know is wheat. So he sowed only what is good and pure in his field. It is his enemy who sows weeds. The weeds do not originate with the household, the man, but from someone who is opposed to him. And when does the enemy sow the weeds? It says, while everyone was asleep. So he came at night, in the darkness, and in secrecy, to sow what was bad. And the enemy was astute. He sowed the weeds in the middle of the wheat. The enemy sowed what was bad in the midst of what was good. And then afterwards it tells us the enemy, after he had sown, went off. Whereas the householder, of course, stands there with the field in what he had planted and then went off. Then the parable moves to the second part, the growing season. When the crop grew and bore fruit, the weeds appeared as well. The slaves of the householder came to him and said, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where have the weeds come from?" His slaves go on to say, "Do you want us to go and pull them up?" And the householder replies, "No. If you pull up the weeds, you might uproot the wheat along with them." Here, the parable is contrasting the householder with his servants. The first reaction of the servants is confusion. The enemy, in sowing the weeds, was able to sow confusion. The servants wonder, how is it that there are weeds in the field when you only sow what was good? The weeds. How is it that now there are the weeds there in the midst of them as well? The second reaction of the servants was to uproot the weeds, to see what was wrong and what was bad. They said, "You want us to go and pull them up." They were offering to uproot what was wrong from the field. The focus of the servants is on the weeds, what is not right. But the man rejects his servant's offer and advice. He says, "No." Why? Because no matter how careful they may be, in uprooting the weeds, they may accidentally uproot some of the wheat. The focus of the household is on the wheat, what is good and what is right in the field. His priority is protecting what is good and what is right, rather than trying to remove what is bad. And so the man is patient and willing to let them grow side by side, the wheat and the weeds. Because for the household, the wheat is more important than the weeds. What is good is more important than what is wrong and bad. And protecting what is good must be the priority. And so he is patient and willing to let the imperfect situation continue. And then the parable moves into the third moment of cultivation, harvesting. And it says, "At harvest time, I will say to the harvesters, first collect the weeds and tie them in bundles for burning, but gather the wheat into my barn." The householder allows them to grow side by side because he is concerned for the wheat in the barn, and because he is certain that his enemy will not succeed and will not have the wheat. Rather, the householder will be able to separate at the harvest time the wheat from the weeds, accepting into his barn what is good and casting off for burning that which is bad. That is the harmony, the parable, that Jesus had preached to the crowds. What does it say to us today? We know that we live in an imperfect world. That is, it's all wheat, things that are good, that there is much wrong in the world. The weeds, shall we say. Things that are not only just contrary to our faith, but are contrary to what is right, and to what is just, and to what is moral. And like the servants, it can often cause us confusion and cause us to wonder. Knowing that God, of course, does not cause what is wrong, we may wonder, why does God permit it to happen? Why does God not stop it? Why does God not remove the weeds as his servants have proposed? In doing so, we have the attitude of the servants. Our focus is on what is wrong. It offends us, and we feel the priority is to remove it, that which is bad. But God is often like the householder. He sees first and foremost what is good. And we know that in the end, God will definitively separate what is good from what is bad.
Thank you. Praise be to brothers, that this our sacrifice may be acceptable to God, Almighty God.
In your Lord, accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and good of all his holy church.
O God, who in the one perfect sacrifice brought to completion very offerings of the law, accept, we pray, the sacrifice of your faithful servants, and make it holy, so that what each has offered to the honor of your majesty may benefit the salvation of all. We ask this through Christ the Lord. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We give them all to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. For in you we live, in whom we can have our being. And while in this body, we not only experience the daily effects of your care, but even now possess the pledge of life eternal. For having received the first fruits of the Spirit, through whom you raised up Jesus from the dead, we hope for an everlasting share in the past of history. And so, with all the angels, we praise you as a joyful celebration. We acclaim.
Thank you.
Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, Stephen our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection, and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them to the light of your presence. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs of your eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am honored and I am ashamed of the matter. But only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
May the body of Christ keep us safe for life and death.
Amen.
Thank you.